السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, this is the final lecture, the sixth in the lectures of the Healing the Ummah series that was arranged by Abdullah Aid. And just a quick brief, Abdullah Aid at the moment is campaigning to provide dialysis to those refugees, the Syrian refugees, who do not have the means to do the dialysis, which is on average 3 times a week. So inshallah, whether it is online, whether it is on your way out, or wherever it may be, consider this. It's a very great cause, inshallah. May Allah Almighty bless them and bless all of us, and write our names from among those who saved entire humanity. Because he says, whoever has contributed towards saving a single life is equivalent to the one who has saved entire humanity. During this beautiful tour, we have come to the conclusion, and it is known, that healing the ummah starts off by healing yourself. If you don't heal yourself, you will not be in the capacity to heal the ummah. But we need the ummah to heal, so we desperately need to heal ourselves. إن الله لا يغير ما بقوم حتى يغيروا ما بأنفسهم. Allah promises and He says that Allah will not change the condition of an ummah or a nation. And we as a Muslim ummah, we are a nation. Allah will not change the condition of a nation until and unless everyone within that nation decides to change himself or herself. So if I want to see the ummah healing, I need to heal first. We spoke about so many aspects of healing in the last few days. Today, we want to speak about how to prepare to return to Allah. One thing that is certain, my beloved children, my brothers, my sisters, my fathers and mothers, one thing that is absolutely certain is that your days on earth are numbered. Your clock is ticking, your seconds are moving. You don't know who's going to be here for the next salah. You don't know whether you are going to be here for the next week. May Allah make it easy the day He decides to take us away. My brothers, my sisters, we are believers. We have been taught through revelation how to prepare for the day that we will be returning to Allah. And when we have made even the slightest preparation, wallahi, we will be excited to meet with Allah. مَنْ أَحَبَّ لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ لِقَاءَهُ. The hadith says, whoever loves the meeting with Allah, looking forward to it with great love, Allah loves to meet with that person. So Allah Almighty wants us to change ourselves for the better as the days pass. We are human. We are human. We falter. We make mistakes. We may have fallen into sin. We may have fallen into minor or major sin. Allah always shows you a way out. Allah is so loving that Adam alayhi salam, the first of our species, when he did something that he was not supposed to do, Allah Almighty taught him the way out immediately. And when he said those words, instantly Allah says, we forgave him. We sent him onto the earth in order that his progeny realizes and understands that whenever they falter because of the tamperings of shaitan, the minute they turn back to me, they will be forgiven. So number one, seek the forgiveness of Allah. My brothers and sisters, look at Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the greatest of all examples. He used to seek forgiveness every single day. Did he need it? No, he didn't. How many times did he used to seek forgiveness a day? Can someone say it? 70 and someone said 100. Both answers are correct. Between 70 and 100 times a day. And he was the prophet of Allah. He was the prophet of Allah, not just an ordinary prophet, but the best of all creation, the most noble of all prophets of Allah, according to our belief. My brothers, my sisters, isn't that an example? A man who did not need it, and he kept saying, "Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me. Oh Allah, forgive me." What did you do? No, it's not a question of what I did. It's a question of elevation of status in the eyes of Allah. I've given an example and I want to repeat it here in this beautiful masjid. They call it the Balfour Road Masjid, right? When someone has done wrong to you, and then they realize they did wrong to you and they come to you and say, "Please forgive me." And you say, "No, it's okay, no problem. Fine, you're forgiven." How many times did they say, "Forgive me"? Once, isn't it? They came to you as a human being, "Please forgive me, I was wrong. I shouldn't have done it. Really, I feel I regret it. I won't do it again." You say, "No, it's okay, not to mention." And then a week later, they see you in the masjid, for example, or somewhere else. "A brother, salamu alaikum, hey, just forgive me, man." But you already said it once, you were already forgiven. Why did you repeat it? Because you're feeling embarrassed, number one. Not because you're doubting that they have forgiven you, but you're just a bit embarrassed. "Hey, I shouldn't have done this." And another thing is, they say, "Nah, not to mention, come on, it's okay." When you see them a third time, a year later, for example, "Hey, I feel so bad. You know what I did was so wrong." Say, "Hey, listen, don't even mention, don't talk about it." But you've repeated it thrice already. Is it because you're doubting that they've forgiven you? No. It's because of your remorse, and it's because you feel that you really did something you were not supposed to. So you become in greater favor with that particular person because you realize, "I need to make up for what bad I've done with good." And the Quran repeats this when it comes to Allah, because Allah's example is higher. Innal hasanati yudhibna as-sayyi'at. Allah says good deeds will wipe out bad deeds. You want to see your bad deeds wiped out, will increase your good deeds, and automatically they will be wiped out. When I feel bad that I did something to a human, and I've already asked them forgiveness so many times, every time I saw them, I would do another thing. I'd try and do good for them. Someone mentions them, "You have a good word to say." Today, someone sent me an email and said, "Such and such a scholar said something about you, about me. And he is like this and he is like that." I replied immediately. I said, "That is a senior scholar of the Muslim Ummah. Please do not mention any negatives about that person because it brings pain to my heart to hear that. It's okay what they've said about me. That's fine. But what is even worse is what you've said about them." What's the idea? The idea is do good to people. What does it cost you? So what if they did bad to you? Ahsin ila man asa'a ilayk. That is a quality of the prophets. Do good to those who did bad to you. Why? I am preparing for the day I want to meet with Allah. Didn't we say today we're talking about healing in that way? You want to heal, you need to seek forgiveness and learn how to forgive others. Without that, you will not heal. There's no healing without seeking forgiveness and learning to forgive others. Look at Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, one of the primary examples in the Quran, where in Surah An-Nur, Allah Almighty makes mention of how his daughter, the mother of the believers, the most chaste of all the women of this dunya, Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was accused of immorality, her father got upset. There was a young lad who was related to them who had made hijrah by the name of Mistah ibn Athatha radiallahu anhu. And her father, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, was spending on this poor man. And he was one of those who spread the tale. Tale meaning it was a fabrication. He spread it. He told people, "Did you hear what happened?" You know, a lot of us do this actually. We don't realize it. Just to say, "Did you hear the latest gossip? Did you hear what happened?" You say, "What happened?" He said, "You know, so-and-so, and such and such and such and such." What did you just do? You spoiled your tongue for nothing. Are you really preparing for the day you're going to return to Allah? No, I forgot for a moment. Literally, shaitan trapped me for a moment and made me talk about somebody else. When the hadith says, Your own weaknesses and sins should keep you away from indulging and engaging negatively in the weaknesses and sins of others. You see? So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu says, Wallahi, Wallahi means he's taking an oath, I will never spend on this man again. Now what was the reason? Because he's spreading tales of immorality against my own daughter, who is the wife of the messenger, who is the mother of the believers, radiallahu anha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows that Abu Bakr is a man of virtue. We believe, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu is the best of all those to tread this earth after the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His number comes first. Abdullah ibn Uthman, Abdullah ibn Abi Quhafa, radiyallahu anhuma, that was his name. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So for him to say something like this, it must be a big deal. He wouldn't say that in a rush. Still Allah tells him, وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah says, those who have been granted virtue by Allah, those who have been granted sustenance by Allah, should never make a promise not to spend upon the poor, and not to spend upon the relatives, and not to spend upon those who have made hijrah, but rather they should forgive and embrace. For indeed, would they not like Allah to forgive them? Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. Did you hear the question? Would they not like Allah to forgive them? In fact, it says, would you not like Allah to forgive you? Amazing. From that verse, we learn that Allah more readily forgives those who readily forgive others. Don't keep it in your heart. What is it worth? How long are you going to be on earth for? How long are you going to be in this worldly life for? Do you really think it's going to help you to keep it in your heart and chest? Do you know that many times when we learn to forgive others, we are actually setting ourselves free before anyone else? We hold a burden on our shoulders, such a burden that it's unbelievable. So difficult, subhanallah, because we have so much. I hold it against this one, that one, this one, that one. If you really want to hold things against people, do you know, you'll end up holding things against everyone, everyone. You come to the masjid and you're the only person who thinks that he is right. That's it. Everyone else, they've done something wrong. Because you're holding too much on your shoulders. Let go, my beloved brother and sister. Let go. It's okay. It's okay. Find it in your heart to let go. I know each one of us has been through different things. Some of you might be seated here, or you might listen to this later, and you might think, he doesn't know what I've been through. I obviously don't know. Allah knows. But if Allah could encourage His most beloved from among those after the prophets of His, who is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, to forgive someone who engaged in such bad behavior, what do you think the example should be for you and I? And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, as soon as he heard the verse, you know what he had to do? First things first. He had to compensate for the oath that he took. Many of us take oaths, we don't even know what compensation is. We don't even know what's a compensation. It's called a kafara. You've got to fast 3 days, you've got to feed so many people, you've got to do, why did you use the name of Allah to do something or to promise something, and then you broke it? And he immediately then broke the promise, seeking the forgiveness of Allah for doing that. And he says, no, I'll spend on him, because Allah instructed me to spend on him. Even though I said, Wallahi, I won't. Because he needed, and we needed, and everyone needed the healing of the ummah. Imagine the grudge was kept. What would have happened? Would the ummah have healed? But that was an example. The question is it compulsory to forgive others? The answer is no, it's not compulsory. If you want to hold it, hold it. But I want to teach you something today. Sometimes when you hold something and you say, I will deal with this man on the day of judgment, people have a right to say that. But sometimes when you say that, you might come on the day of judgment and a few scenarios could take place. Firstly, you might find out on that day that that person was not actually wrong. When justice comes, there's a chance, maybe something happened behind the scenes that you did not know. And so you're not aware. I'd rather just let go. It's okay. Or you might find you were right. You got the justice, but you were caught because of other things that you did against Allah that He's now holding against you. Subhanallah. Had you released, Allah says, we will release. Forgive. Don't you want to be forgiven? That's what the verse says. Forgive. Haven't you done wrong things in your life? Yes, I have. Well, you forgive, we will forgive. That's exactly what Allah is telling you. He's encouraging you. But Allah's mercy is great. So you want to heal within, learn to forgive. And learn to seek forgiveness. Who should I seek forgiveness from? Ultimately, Allah. Oh Allah, if I have wronged you, forgive me, strengthen me. And if I have wronged others, oh Allah, you help me to seek the forgiveness of that person. Help me to seek the forgiveness of that person. It is so embarrassing when we find out that I have wronged someone from the ummah or wherever it may be, and we have to actually go to that person and say, you know what, I seek forgiveness. In our language, we say you had to eat humble pie. You had to eat what? Humble pie. I'd rather eat humble pie in the dunya than to be cast somewhere that I don't want to be in the hereafter. My brother, I'm sorry. I want to tell you all today, if I have hurt you or offended you in any way, knowingly, unknowingly, firstly, may Allah forgive me. And secondly, may you all forgive me. A day will come when I have to return to Allah. You have to return to Allah. If you don't have a concern for that day, you have a lot of work and a lot to work on and a lot of improvement. Because don't deceive yourself. Your days are numbered. Your clock is ticking. Your sand timer has already clocked. Perhaps more than half of the sand is down. Maybe almost all of it is down. Maybe a few grains are left. Who knows? You know what's a sand timer? Be concerned about the day you're going to go back to Allah. You will heal. And then the second point about healing is to have good hope in the mercy of Allah. أحسن الظن بالله. Have good hope in the mercy of Allah. Think good about Allah. Don't just think He's going to punish you, hurt you, hit you, affect you, inflict you, and so on. No, 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 no. Did Allah not provide for you in this dunya so much? What do you think He provided you for? Do you really think you and I deserve what we've been given? We've been given more than what we deserve. One narration says that when man looks at all his acts of worship and wants to see a compensation for it, Allah Almighty will ask a question. أَلَمْ نَصِحَّ لَكَ بَدَنَكَ وَنُرَوِّكَ بِالْمَاءِ الْبَارِدِ. Did we not give you good health and quench your thirst with cold water? Yes, well, that was enough for all that you did. Subhanallah. What about my eyes, my nose, my ears, my lips, my tongue, my beard, my hair, my what, my this, my arms, my biceps, my triceps, and what else? I had to say that for the youngsters, huh? Mashallah. What about all of that? You can see. Can you not see me today, the bulk of you, or almost all of us? How much did you pay for that? You can't even pray Salatul Fajr, but you can see clearly. How long can you see for? You can see. Can you hear me? May Allah grant us goodness in our hearing and our ears.
لهم قلوب لا يفقهون بها ولهم أعين لا يبصرون بها ولهم آذان لا يسمعون بها.
Allah speaks about something worse. Allah says some people are so misguided they have hearts that they don't understand with, meaning they're not prepared to utilize their brains and minds. And secondly, they have eyes but they can't see, they have ears they can't hear with. Because it's not impacting upon them. What do you want to be told before you change? Have we not been breathing? What did you pay for your breath? Has your heart been not pumping? Has your heart not been pumping? How many times a day on average does your heart pump? I'm sure you guys know. Someone say it. 136,000 times a day. In 24 hours, what's the average? 136,000 times your heart pumps. Did you know that? On average per day. What did you pay for that? Can you not say Subhanallah at least once a day? La ilaha illallah. While you are sitting here, your heart is just going doof doof, doof doof, doof doof, doof doof. Subhanallah. Amazing, amazing. Come on, come on. That's Lord of the Worlds. You paid nothing, zero. If you miss one beat from 136,000, you are prepared to pay whatever you own in order to remain afloat and to let that heart continue pumping. You'll be rushed to this hospital and that one and everyone. Everyone around you is all uneasy. Everyone's lost their sleep because you missed and skipped one or two heartbeats. You're going to go back to Allah. Make peace with Allah. Make peace with those around you. The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says there was once a man. The companions say, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if you want to see a man from Jannah, look at this man. When they looked at him, they didn't really find him doing a lot of extra ibadah. But when they asked a question to him, what is it that you're engaging? He says, every night before I sleep, I remove from my heart ghil, ghil, which means the hatred and the ill feeling against anyone else. I remove it, take it out. I die, I've healed, and I've allowed myself to heal by letting it go. Let it go. You don't let it go, it's a burden. I know you might be sitting, like I said earlier, and thinking, well, I don't want to let it go. It's a big one. Someone has pinched my money. No problem. You have every right to pursue it. Justice is justice in Islam. Someone stole your quid, for example, you can get it back. Brother, I need my money, but I've forgiven you otherwise, but the money, bring it back. Subhanallah. The money is mine. The rest of it is okay, fine. I might need to go to higher authority to get my money back. It's not wrong. Ask yourself, how much money does this person owe me? Right? And ask yourself, how much am I prepared to do to get that money? Am I prepared to lose to get the money? If they owe you a small amount, and what you're going to do to get it back is going to cause you damage in your health and your well-being and your spirituality, rather let it go. It's okay. One day, someone bumped into my car. Many, many years ago. I came out, I looked at it, I said, goodbye. I thought to myself, I'm going to sit here and everything's going to happen and the police are going to come and this damage is worth 200 quid. Subhanallah. And you know what? It's going to take up 5 hours of mine. 1 hour of mine is worth maybe 1,000 quid, for example. Sorry, that's not my earning, by the way. I see one of the youngsters saying, you said it. MashaAllah. But what I mean is, it's the tension, the mind, the head, and everything. Imagine I said, it's okay, let it be, because it's some few scratches here. Instead of all the tension, but if it's a big damage, I'm allowed to say, okay, let me wait, because I need this car to be repaired and whatever else and so on. So you need to gauge it and ask yourself, is it worth it? Is it worth it? You know, one of the stories that really moves me to tears. It moves me to tears. The grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was his name? Abdul Muttalib, Jazakallah khair. What's your name? Ammar, mashallah. Abdul Muttalib, the time when Abraha came, you know who was Abraha? He came with an elephant in order to destroy the Kaaba, and he came with his army. And when he came with his army, guess what he did? You know, these tyrants, when they come in, they want to steal everybody's everything, right? So they started stealing the camels of the people. So he stole so many camels, they usurped the camels of Abdul Muttalib. And Abdul Muttalib was the man in charge of the Kaaba. He was the man in charge at the time. He was the leader. So when he heard, they all knew that this man is coming to destroy the Kaaba. He made it clear. Coming to what? To break the Kaaba. When Abdul Muttalib heard that his camels were gone, he came to Abraha and said, I need my camels. Please give me these camels back. Now you know there's tension because the man's asking boldly for his camels. Abraha says, you know what? You're foolish, because I am coming here to destroy the Kaaba. It's going to finish you guys up because nobody's ever going to come here again. And you're busy worried about your camels? Guess what he said?
أَنَا رَبُّ الْإِبِلِ وَأَمَّا الْبَيْتِ فَلَهُ رَبٌّ يَحْمِيهِ.
He says, I am the owner of the camels. I'm asking you for my camels. That house, it has a Lord. He'll deal with you. Allahu Akbar, he will protect it. The house has a Lord who will protect it. Subhanallah, Rabbil Alameen. What happened?
أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ أَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ كَيْدَهُمْ فِي تَضْلِيلٍ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِّن سِجِّيلٍ فَجَعَلَهُمْ كَعَصْفٍ مَّأْكُولٍ.
A whole surah was revealed because of that. Allah says, did you see what happened to those people of the elephant? And the end of that surah, Allah says, he destroyed them in our language to smithereens. Smithereens, gone. With what? With little birds. Little birds holding small pebbles from high altitude. That's also a scientific miracle. Scientific miracle. The higher that you drop, the higher the altitude from which you drop something, the greater the force within with which it drops. Subhanallah. Small pebbles destroyed them. When I go to Mecca, and I'm sure many of us have been, whenever I look at those birds around the Kaaba, and it's always birds. You notice there's always birds. And they may not be the exact ababil, but I always tell myself, Allah has junood that you don't know, and I don't. Allah has armies. You don't realize anything, anytime can finish you and I up. May Allah protect us. But Allah says,
وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ.
When it comes to punishment, Allah says, we will not punish them while they are seeking forgiveness. That's why I started off today's talk by saying, seek forgiveness. Allah will not punish you. If you are seeking forgiveness and something very negative is happening to you, it's the mercy of Allah. It's not punishment. It cannot be punishment. My brothers and sisters, as believers, we do not believe that everything man perceives as negative is negative. Anything that brought you closer to Allah, even if it looked as negative, a loss, some health problem, some other issue, a divorce, if something brought you closer to Allah, it is the rahmah of Allah. It is the mercy of Allah. You lost your eyesight, you are diagnosed some terminal illness, if it brought you closer to Allah, I swear by Allah, it is a rahmah of Allah. It's a rahmah of Allah. And anything you think is good that took you away from Allah is actually dangerous for you. It could be the adab. In one verse of the Quran, Allah proves it. Allah tells us,
فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أبواب كل شيء حتى إذا فرحوا بما أوتوا أخذناهم بغتة فإذا هم مبلسون.
Allah speaks about how some people, when they forget Allah completely, Allah opens the doors of this worldly material life for them. They begin to amass it, thinking that Allah is happy with them. But because they are far from Allah, Allah says, when they totally forget us, we overtake them with sudden punishment, destroying them, and they are confused. Why are they confused? Oh Allah, you gave me, but now you're destroying me. Allah says, we gave you as a punishment, not as a mercy. So whenever we want to earn, ask Allah, become humble, come to Allah. Today, earlier on, I was talking to a group of friends, and one guy was saying how he lost this deal and lost that deal and lost that deal and lost this deal. I, just as a reminder, told him, my brother, add two more Subhana Rabbi al-A'las in your sujood, and inshallah, next time you'll tell me I got this deal and that deal and that deal, because the owner of the key of your deals is the one to whom you prostrate. Not you and I. I don't need to know you in order to get the deal. I need to know the owner of you and I and all the deals. Come closer to Allah. Allah will open the doors. We heal. We all will heal by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we seek forgiveness. And we forgive others. And have good thoughts of Allah. أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي. What a powerful hadith Qudsi. Hadith Qudsi. Qudsi means that Allah Almighty, the Prophet peace be upon him, is telling us that he said this. It's not Quran, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying Allah said this. Allah said, I treat each one of my slaves according to his or her perception of me. Have a good perception of Allah. I want to tell you something else. The magicians at the time of Musa alayhi salam, were they not the men of Fir'aun? They belonged to Fir'aun's group. When they saw that, hey, this is not magic, man. This is not magic. As soon as they saw it, what was the first thing they did? They fell prostrate. How many prostrations do you know? Just one. After that, what happened? Fir'aun threatened them, warned them, and executed them. Then what happened? Allah forgave them. For them is Jannah. How many prostrations? One. You and I, how many prostrations? We lost count. May Allah accept from us even one. Amen. Thank Allah. Allah has given you a chance to put your head on the ground. Thank Him. Take your time in sujood. أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبُدُ لِرَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدٌ. The closest you can ever be to your Lord is in the position of sujood. Take your time. Take your time, my brothers, my sisters. Take your time in sujood, no matter what. You are close to Allah. Take your time. Relax. You will heal. Your problems will be solved and dissolved. Why? You are with the Lord of the worlds. What do you have? What are you suffering? What are you struggling? كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا حزبه أمر فزع إلى الصلاة. Whenever Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم had an important matter, anything that bothered him slightly, he would immediately resort to salah. Pray. Two units of prayer. Ask Allah. Cry to Allah. What do you want? First, call out to Allah. Firstly, you ask Allah. Ya غلام. إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله. Oh, young man, when you are asking, ask Allah. First ask Allah, you ask Allah. And when you are seeking help, seek help from Allah, Allah alone.
واعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بما قد كتبه الله لك ولو اجتمعوا على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك إلا بما قد كتبه الله عليك رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف.
You need to know, if the entire Ummah gets together to benefit you, they will never be able to benefit you except with that which Allah has written for you. And if the whole Ummah and the entire nation gets together to harm you, they will never be able to harm you except with that which Allah has written against you. The pens have been lifted and the pages are dry. Your destiny is written, sealed. I don't know my destiny. That's why I keep working. People say, if Allah knows who's going to Jannah and who's going to Jahannam, why am I wasting my time? The reason is because you don't know, that's why. Simple answer, you don't know. Had you known, then you could have said, I'm wasting my time, right? But you don't, simple answer, because you do not know. Who from amongst us knows where they're going already? I can put up my hand. You know what I can say? Insha'Allah Jannah. Insha'Allah. Insha'Allah means Allah will. Insha'Allah Jannah. And we can all say the same. So the fact that Allah knows doesn't mean that you have to stop doing deeds, because then you would have been the fool. You don't know. It's like the man who comes and he had stolen and they were going to punish him at the time of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he looks at the Jallad. The Jallad is the executioner who executes the punishment. He says, you know what? Hang on. It was the taqdeer and the predestiny of Allah, chosen by Allah, that I was going to steal. So why are you punishing me? So here, that's a sharp one. That's a very sharp one, right? He says, it was predestined. Do you believe in predestiny? Yes, I do. Well, if Allah wrote that I was going to steal, what are you punishing me? So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu tells the executioner, go ahead, carry on, do it, because Allah also wrote that we were going to punish him. May Allah Almighty forgive us. You'd like to heal? Have good hope in Allah. When you seek forgiveness, believe that you are forgiven. Change your ways and your habits. Feel in your heart your connection with Allah. Have a good hope. Allah is loving. Allah is merciful. The qualities of Allah that are connected with mercy, love, and forgiveness are the most, and they are tremendous. He is most loving, most forgiving, oft forgiving. He loves to forgive. Look at the dua of Laylatul Qadr, and we should be repeating it every other day. Allahumma innaka afuun tuhibbu al-afwa. What does that mean? Have you thought about it? It means, oh Allah, you love to forgive. You love to forgive. Why would Allah love to forgive? He knows He has created His slaves who will sin and err. He loves from amongst us those who return to Him and repent to Him. Those are the ones whom Allah loves. If you think you are never going to sin, listen to this. Kullu bani Adam khatta. Wa khayrul khatta'in at-tawwabun. All human beings, all the children of Adam, they commit sin, they are prone to error. But the best from among those who often sin, because the term khatta refers to someone who did it more than once. At-tawwabun, those who repent more than once, again, tawwabun, of repenting. How many times do you seek the forgiveness of Allah? Believe in the mercy of Allah. You are growing a bit older. You might be terminally ill. You might be young. Learn to love Allah and feel the love of Allah back. Allah loves you. When He takes you away, be convinced that you are going to a good place. Why? Are you not a mu'min? Did you not say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah? That statement alone heals. It will heal the ummah. The bond, don't we say the bond of La ilaha illallah is stronger than the bond of blood? You hear the hadith of Bitaqa. It's called the hadith of the card. It's reported that on the day of Qiyamah, a slave will come forth with sins. 99 files filled with sins, each one from the east to the west. And as Allah Almighty says, put his deeds on the scale, they are being put on the scale. People used to ask, how will they weigh the deeds? Isn't it? How will they weigh the deeds? I don't know how they will weigh the deeds. I don't know how they will write the deeds, but I know they write it, and I know they will wait, and I know there's going to be a scale of justice, because the Quran says it, the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says it, I believe in it. And so, today when you video something, or when you have an audio and you save, it takes up part of your memory. How much? There's a weight. Megabytes. Agreed? Gigabytes. Sometimes too big. Terabytes. And so on. You can weigh it. If you can weigh my speech in megabytes, MP3, wave, etc. It's so simple for Allah to do whatever He wants to weigh my whole life out. So we don't ever deny the scales of justice. One of the beautiful things about the scale is it depicts the mercy of Allah. How? Allah says, I'm not looking for someone who only got one side of the scale, good only. No. Allah says, فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُ. Whoever's good deeds are more than the bad, they have won. Allah didn't say whoever does not have bad deeds. The mercy of Allah is He's going to weigh your deeds. How many good, how many bad? Okay, say for example, we're weighing in kilos. I got 5 kilos of bad and 10 kilos of good. What happened to me? I won. And that's why be careful the weight of your deeds. Some deeds that we do bad and we think, it's تَحْسَبُونَهُ عَيِّنًا وَهُوَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٌ. When you accuse someone of immorality, Allah says in the Quran, speaking about the accusation of immorality against Aisha radiallahu anha, Allah says, these people think it's a light matter, yet in the eyes of Allah, it is azim. It is a huge thing. How could you? How dare you said that? This is why you want to prepare for the meeting with Allah. Watch your tongue. Watch your tongue and watch your private parts. من يضمن لي ما بين لحييه وما بين فخذيه أضمن له الجنة.
Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam came out and he gave a guarantee of paradise to people who looked after two things: that which is between your cheeks, which means your tongue; that which is between your thighs, which means your private parts. You look after those two, he says, I guarantee you paradise. No ways that you're not going to get it.
How can we lose hope from the guarantee of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
One might say, well, I haven't been using my tongue well. Someone else might say, I fell in immorality. I tell you what, you're alive. Seek the forgiveness of Allah. The Quran says, in a beautiful verse,
وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ.
Whoever has wronged themselves, committed immorality, those who've committed immorality or wronged themselves, they've committed a sin against themselves, if they remember and they turn back to Allah seeking forgiveness and they do good deeds thereafter, you know what Allah says?
أُولَٰئِكَ جَزَاؤُهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَجَنَّاتٌ.
Those are the ones for whom is the forgiveness of Allah and paradise. Who are they? Those who have a sinful past. P-A-S-T in our language. Past. For as long as it is a sinful past and not a sinful present and not a sinful future, you have hope. If you have a sinful present, make it past. Let it be past tense. It's no longer. From today, it's cut. It's over. I don't need. I'm preparing for the day I'm going to meet with Allah. Like I said, my sand timer has a few more grains. I'm fortunate. Imagine Allah's telling you, those who committed immorality and sought the forgiveness of Allah after that and changed their lives and did good deeds, Allah says, that is gone. There is another verse where Allah helped you to heal even beyond this. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah says,
فَأُولَٰئِكَ يُبَدِّلُ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ حَسَنَاتٍ.
If you've changed your life after you sinned and committed adultery and did whatever you did, but you changed your life, Allah says, you know what we will do? Because you changed your life for our sake, we will convert the bad deeds you did and bring them onto the other side of the scale and make them into good deeds for you. It's a verse of the Quran. Imagine the healing Allah gives you. You feel so good about it. This is what makes you look forward to the next ibadah, to the next prayer. I love you, Allah. You have really shown so much of mercy to me. You've given me what I don't even deserve. And you continue to bless me when I don't even deserve the least that you've given. Has Allah not blessed us? Ask yourself, what do you think you deserve? Allah says, if you only look at the way we quenched your thirst on a hot day with cold water, that would deplete your ibadah. That's why we believe that we will never ever enter paradise by our deeds. We will enter it by the mercy of Allah. So one might say, you know, I deal with a lot of young people, young children and teenagers and so on. And you get some really clever questions. One young lad comes to me and says, you said that we will never enter Jannah with our deeds, but we will enter Jannah through the mercy of Allah. What if I don't do deeds and I just ask Allah for His mercy? Is that not a clever question? So I said, listen, my son, how do you get the mercy of Allah? By doing deeds. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Get up for Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr. Allah's mercy comes in your direction. You might not have full concentration. We were doing Salatul Asr just now. Not one of us has 100% concentration. Maybe the best from amongst us perhaps is 80. You are a human. Don't be too hard on yourself. You know that. We always say when you get too hard on yourself, you won't be able to worship Allah with joy, with beauty. Allah knows you. You're a human. Be a human. Don't pretend to be an angel. You're a human. You want the mercy of Allah? Try. Try what? I'm going to do my Quran in the morning. I'm going to do my adhkar. I'm going to seek the forgiveness of Allah. I'm going to reach out to the poor. I'm going to visit the sick. I'm going to change my habits. I'm going to seek Allah's mercy by tongue as well. Allah will show you mercy.
But when you don't do any deeds and you're just saying, oh Allah, mercy, oh Allah, mercy, oh Allah, mercy. It's like the guy who's sitting at home and saying, today I need to go for Jumu'ah. So all you need to do, my brother, is jump into your vehicle, take a drive to the masjid or phone someone, tell them, come pick me up, and then you get to the masjid. But if you're going to sit on your bed and say, oh Allah, I want to go for Jumu'ah, oh Allah, I want to go. That's exactly what it is. Allah says, I gave you hands, I gave you a car, I gave you everything. Get up and go. So in the same way, you want the mercy of Allah. How do you get it? Do deeds. Your deeds might be slightly broken. It's okay. So for as long as you did your best, as long as you tried to do it in the best way that you were taught, you will heal. Allah will make you enjoy your ibadah. If you are not enjoying your acts of worship, you need to check where you're going wrong. Have you wronged someone? Have you hurt someone? Have you harmed someone? Are you engaged in some sin that is hidden? If you are engaging in sin, what is taken away from you is ladhat al-ibadah. The sweetness of worship is taken away from you because there is a sin that you keep going back to. You know what it may be. You keep going back to this thing. For that, when you do your salah, you won't enjoy it. You see, sometimes you watch the masjid. Some of the people, they're always in the masjid, always doing Quran, always reading. Even some of our sisters and ladies and mums and grandmums, when they're sitting at home, for example, they will recite with the Quran for hours on end. They're enjoying it. They're reading. They're looking. And you're wondering, I went, I see my mother's reading. I came back. I see she's still reading. I came back. She's in salah. I went. As I went out, she's still in salah. Doesn't it happen? They are enjoying the sweetness of worship. And with us, salah time is coming. Ah, it's okay. Pogba is still kicking the ball. Subhanallah, the man himself is also reading salah. And you are busy watching him without reading salah. It's ironic. I have seen sports persons who are more concerned about their salah than their fans. If you're a true fan, fulfill the salah just like they do. Subhanallah. You really want a good example? There goes. Cricketers. I know of some cricketers who are really amazing people. As Muslimin. I'm sure you might know some too. But my brothers and sisters, I tell you, Allah has blessed us. Allah has blessed us in so many ways. And Allah Almighty tells us we need to engage in the best that we can. When I started here, I said I'm going to speak for 45 minutes. Balfour has so much barakah, it's 47 minutes and I haven't yet started. I pray that Allah grant us a healing. And I pray that Allah bless every one of us. Like you can see, these talks are a whole series. We can go on and on. But for now, what we've said, may Allah Almighty accept it. I want to end off by mentioning one quick point. Learn to love each other for the sake of Allah. Learn to love each other for the sake of Allah. I tell you something. There is a hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks about seven categories of people who will enter Jannah, meaning who will get a special shade on the day of Qiyamah. A special shade on the day of Qiyamah, the day of judgment, when it will be very hot. From among them, there are seven categories. It's not my topic today, but I want to mention the point of love. Rajulani tahabba fillahi. Two people who loved each other for the sake of Allah. Two people who loved each other for the sake of Allah. Why is this so important? Let me explain quickly. There are many reasons, but one of them is, every one of us is different. Your temperament is different. Your mind is different. Your thinking is different. Your likes and dislikes are different. You could be twins born to the same parents at almost the same time, but you will still be different. What this one says and what this one likes, and your brothers are different. Cousins are different. People in the community are very different. Very, very different. You might have some similarities. Allah created you different in order to give you an opportunity to engage in ibadah. In an ibadah. What is the ibadah? To be able to respect one another even with your difference. It's okay, this person, a little bit temperamental, go easy with them. It's okay, they didn't mean it. Some people, they don't keep anything in their heart. They just say things. They just tell you as it is on your face. Other people, they have a certain way to tell you. It's okay, both are right. Some people might get a bit temperamental very fast. Calm down. When you're around them, be conscious of it. Allah will grant you reward. And some people, no matter what you say, they're still calm and cool and laughing. It's okay. These are different temperaments. Ashkal wa alwan. Allah created you different in order for you to recognize one another. In order for you to engage in ibadah with one another. Allah made you related to the same people you don't get along with, if that's your brother or your sister. Because Allah made it your duty to engage in fulfillment of your family relations and to fulfill their rights, yet they are different. لَيْسَ الْوَاصِلُ بِالْمُكَافِئِ إِنَّمَا الْوَاصِلُ الَّذِي مَنْ إِذَا قُطِعَ رَحِمُهُ وَصَلَحَ. The hadith says, a person who maintains family ties is not the one who just has a tit-for-tat relationship with them. You do, I do. You came, I went. It's the one whom, when one party has broken and cut off a relation, they go to try and mend it for the sake of Allah. You get a reward for free. My brother, please forgive me, I was wrong. What did it cost you to say that? Some of us, we can't even say that. Come what may, I tell people, even if you are not really wrong, you really care for the day you're going to go back to Allah. If I am sorry, is going to solve your problem, say it. Say it. I'm sorry. Khalas, it solved a mountain. I'm sorry. And then please don't go back and say, well, I wasn't really sorry. Because some people are like this. They'll tell you, we were just told to say, I'm sorry, so I'm sorry. And then you go back and spoil everything. I'm sorry. So I want to solve the matter. Let's start again. So my brothers and sisters, the last thing. When someone asks your forgiveness, try to forgive them. When someone says, you know what, I really apologize and I want your forgiveness. It's not easy to go to another person and seek forgiveness. So if they did come, no problem. Make them feel comfortable. You know, sometimes people might come back to you and say, yeah, you see, I knew you would come back and so on. Don't rub salt to a wound. Help them heal. You help them heal and Allah will give you a healing in the dunya and the akhirah. I look forward to meeting you all again sometime in the dunya. If not, inshallah, in the highest ranks of Jannatul Firdaus. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.